What I would like to do is to show the relationship between fascia and the second law of thermodynamics. The first book of medicine that I could find was written by Imhotep 5,000 years ago, and this is a 17-page manuscript dealing with 48 cases on how we can heal battle wounds. Case number 17 is a mandibular injury. Here is a diagnostic as written by Imhotep. Now, he has a treatment for that kind of injury, which consists in first sprinkle alum powder on the injury, then cover the injury with a piece of a steak of a cow, and then wait for a week. And if this does not work, then we can say an incantation and hope for the best. There are several comments here. First, Imhotep did not know that the alum powder has antibacterial properties and that fresh meat has enzymes that can speed up healing. But experience told him that doing so would help. He also knew that a placebo, like a prayer or an incantation, could also have a positive effect on the recovery of the patient. There is a second comment which we can derive, is that there is no need to understand how an aspirin will work to demonstrate it is useful. And therefore, it is not necessary to have a diagnosis and a treatment logically related to produce good result to the patient. In other words, good results do not imply good diagnosis. But it became clear that a good understanding of normal anatomy and the changes that occurred with trauma was a prerequisite for rehabilitations. That concept was followed by Egyptians, Greek, Romans, and many, many others who started to study how we are constructed. I will name only Aristotle, Hippocrates, Leonardo da Vinci, and so on. Now, the question of how do we move was dealt with in the Renaissance by people like Harvey for the blood circulations and Borelli for the mechanics of the arm and the lifting. In the 19th century, physics introduced the concept of thermodynamics to explain the behavior of a newly invented steam engine. Sadi Carnot, an engineer from France, was indeed interested in those new machines because he was dealing with the property of heat to be transformed and to permit extractions of mechanical power. The steam engine has about 3% efficiency, which is very low. We can compare that with a car, a modern car, which has about 30% efficiency. The question was further studied in the mid-1800s by Rudolf Clausius, who expressed the second law of thermodynamics, whereby the energy will degrade with time and is less and less available to do some work. Ludwig Boltzmann wanted to measure the degradation of energy, that is, the amount of disorder which appears in the structures as the energy degrades. Entropy is a measure of that disorder. It measures the chaos. Since the universe moves from order to disorder, its entropy always increases. But there are situations where disorder can also create order. That will be the process of life. Let's consider the case of a pregnant woman. What she does is eat food and process disorganized particles of food into an organized structure, which is her baby. That does not violate the second law of thermodynamics, because this use of energy degrades overall. Hence, the result within the universe context will result in an increase of disorder. What are the rules to be followed? Well, Einstein linked energy and matter. The energy is equal to the mass times the square of the velocity of the light. That expresses how much energy is necessary to construct the matter contained in our body. And the mechanism by which the elementary atomic particles assemble themselves, including in life, is dictated by the law that drives the evolution of energy. The sequence is as follows. The sun provides energy by fusing hydrogen into helium, and then further fusion will create all the atomic blocks which we know. When the sun runs out of his life, supernova explosions will scatter these building blocks across the universe. But then the blocks may recombine into new structures which are more stable because they have a lower energy signature. For example, water. It is made of oxygen and two hydrogen atoms. Now, in order to construct and link hydrogen and oxygen, a considerable amount of energy must be released. In other words, if we wanted to separate hydrogen from oxygen, we will have to provide the molecule of water with a heck of a lot of energy. This is why water is very stable and makes a lot of our body. As a consequence, people do not evaporate spontaneously on the beach. Now, the building blocks of life were discovered in 1952 by Miller and Urey, who were able to produce amino acids by running an electric discharge in a vapor containing water, methane, ammonia, and hydrogen. And here is how they did it. They simulated the ocean by water in a container, evaporated this water containing the mix of the various chemicals, passed it through an electric discharge. What we see here is the ocean, the water, being boiled, and the molecules of water, methane, ammonia, and hydrogen travels in the atmosphere and be excited by the storm, electrical storm, which we know we have on the planet. That simulates the weather, if you want, on the planet. After a week of this treatment, Miller and Urey observed that they could create 20 amino acids, which are the basis block of living organism. This was important because the creation of amino acids was made independently of anything else. It was strictly a chemical process. And hence, the basic components of life is something driven by the second law of thermodynamics. The entire animal can be constructed, by assembling so-called dead nuclear materials by following the guidance, the path of the evolution in the degradation of the energy. We need to consider some energy minimizations because the assembly of molecules into something more stable and energy efficient is a very basic driving force behind the design of our anatomy. Now, once you get several configurations, several forms of life, we have to test them to decide which one will survive. That problem was resolved by the great Darwin, who produced the concept of evolution, in which survival is the objective that must be implemented by the anatomy. In other words, function determines the anatomy. So evolution can be seen as the ultimate trial and error testing method and be an expression of the second law of thermodynamics. Voici an example of energy use and survival. A need air dental use 4,000 calories per day to survive. Homo sapiens needs only 2,200 calories per day. And so we see that the Homo sapiens is much more energy efficient than the Neanderthal, which may explain his survival. So question now is, where does that energy come from? That will explain now the need for collagen. Once the fish lands on Earth 375 million years ago, it landed with a bunch of bones and muscles. However, those bones and muscles were now exposed to the gravitational field of the planet, and that made some changes possible, which represented an opportunity for the design and use of a new material, which is the collagen. Now, why is fascia indispensable? Because muscles are gas guzzler, and the animal must minimize their use for survival. Therefore, a structural material capable of transmitting forces without significant energy cost will be very advantageous. And collagen, which is called fascia, does it. First question: what is the most efficient structure capable of building the animal using tensile components like collagen and muscles and compressive components like the bone? And the second question is, what is the impact of the Earth's gravitational field on the organizations of the fascial material? Let's first construct the animal. The power source is in the muscles. Then we have to transmit that power wherever it's needed, say in the arms. That is done by a combination of muscles and fascia. So we have two materials available to do that: bone, which can handle compression, and collagen, which can handle tension. How do we design an animal on that basis? Well, tensegrity offered one solution to this problem. Tensegrity is a technique for building structures by decomposing forces into their compressive and tensile components. Here is an example with this delta plane where the tension is sent through the cables and the compression through the rods. Here, shear is the enemy. It is the enemy because material that can resist shear is very heavy, much heavier and complicated than material that can sustain tension and compression. Hence, having shear forces requires a system, an animal, that will be very energy inefficient. Tensor gravity can construct all kinds of shapes. You have a snake here and the pelvis of a human made with tension and compression elements. So any structure can be constructed to avoid supporting shear forces. The problem with the shear is that, again, to build something that can resist shear is complicated and heavy and energy inefficient. An example of the cucumbers is that they did not evolve to support shear forces, and by the way, we did not either. Here is Louis XVI in 1793, which demonstrate that humans do not support shear forces very well. Look at this pencil. It is very difficult to break it by pulling it this way. However, if I apply a shear force like that, it will break, because the pencil is not designed to resist the shear force, and so are we. And so the question, how can we control the posture of the skeleton to prevent the gravitational forces from generating dangerous shear forces in the tissues? The root of the confusion here started in the 1940s, where Bartling proposed that back muscles must do the lifting. That idea is even believed today, in spite of the evidence of the contrary. In order to optimize the musculoskeletal system, we have to use tools that were developed for the flights to the moon, because we had to save energy resources to bring the astronauts back to Earth. In biomechanical terms, the problem is to find the best distribution of forces between muscle and fascia to ensure function at minimum energy cost. And hence, the lumbar dorsal fascia ended up as being a central component to explain the spinal motion. The idea of Bartling could be improved. This is what he proposed, namely that the muscle of the erector spinae would balance the external load which we have in our hands. However, we can calculate that the maximum load that can be lifted with the erector spinae is about 50 kilo. Now we have a problem, because Olympic weightlifters can lift 325 kilo, which is quite a bit more. How can you explain that? And Bartling proposed that the abdominal pressure will rise, push up the diaphragm, and therefore provides the missing force needed to lift heavy loads. But if we calculate how much pressure we need to lift 200 kilo, we ran into a very severe problem. In addition, the big size needed by the erector spinae to do that will result in the vertebra to be crushed by the excessive compression. So the real anatomy must be modified. The idea of Bartling must be complemented by the addition of the lumbar dorsal fascia, which supplies the missing moment to lift heavy loads. And therefore, what we have is a combination muscle ligaments, which are permitting us to lift loads. The distribution of loads between muscle and ligament is very interesting. The muscle takes 20% and the ligaments 80%. In other words, if you have to cut something in surgery, it is better to cut the muscles and save the collagen. Now, let's have a look at the force transmission system of the lumbar dorsal fascia and all the back structures. The problem here is to make space for the abdominal content, because we must feed ourselves, have the lungs working, but we must also use the muscle that surround the abdominal cavity for all the tasks than keeping the cavity closed. We would like to use those muscles for locomotion, for example. And hence, we have now two groups of muscles to consider. First, the muscles which are aligned with the spine, biceps femoris, gluteus maximus, erectoris spinae, and then we have other muscles which are not aligned with the spine, even perpendicular to the spine, such as transversus abdominis or the oblique. Here is some details here. The very deep layer transmits the force of biceps femoris through the sacrotuberous ligament, iliocostalis, up to the upper extremities. Then we have what is called the deep layer of the fascia, where gluteus maximum transfers the forces through the fascia latissimus dorsi to the humerus. And finally, on top of this, the superficial layer, which transfers the force of the transversus abdominis, convert it into an axial pull that will extend the spine. Let's have a look at that particular feature. Here we have the superficial layer of the fascia, which is connected to transversus through the lateral raphe. When transversus pull on the lateral raphe, we can see that the spinous processes are being brought closer together because of the very special arrangement of the collagenous structure. This model shows how a lateral pull of transversus will induce spinal extension. That technique is used by manual labor people, either by flexing the trunk, which permits the collagen to be tightened and therefore the muscle to relax and not use unnecessary energy, or by rotating the pelvis, which is the same thing. You rotate the pelvis and the fascia is being tightened. Now, we have to compare now the Homo sapiens with the other kind of monkeys. Notice that Homo sapiens has a very small amount of muscle in the erectoris spinae region, whereas the old monkey have a lot of muscle. They have to have a lot of muscles because they have a weak collagen structure, a weak lumbar dorsal fascia, and therefore they cannot transmit efficiently the power of the hip extensors. We have a strong lumbar dorsal fascia and we can therefore transmit the force of the hip extensors without requiring a big muscle mass. Therefore, the fascia permits an erect stance with minimal spinal musculature. Hence, monkeys are quadrupeds, because they do not have a proper fascia structure. Now, we have not to compromise something because we would like to have muscle relaxation, which is having the fascia to be loaded, but we cannot keep the fascia continuously loaded because it is viscoelastic. And in a matter of seconds, a constant pull on the viscoelastic fascia will stretch it, and then the fascia will lose its force transmission ability. This is observed when we look weightlifters lifting heavy loads. They have to do it within a third of a second, because if they waited 1 second, the fascia will stretch, the muscle will have to take over what the fascia cannot do, but we know we do not have enough erectory spinae mass, and therefore instead of being collapsing with the load, the weightlifter must drop the weight. This implies that there must be continuous postural modifications to permit the force of the hip extensors to be sent through the fascia, through the erectory spinae, through all kinds of different paths. In other words, the pathway for forces will be changing dynamically. There is another compromise. Yes, we have a multiplicity of pathways to transmit forces. And so we have to have period of work, period of rest. The continuity in the fascia structures should not be limited to being a geometrical continuity, but rather as being a functional continuity in the flow of forces needed to compensate and correct for the viscoelasticity of the collagen. Because the gravitational forces will not permit us to rest while standing up, we have to switch the various components in order to use our material the most efficiently. And hence the fascia in various planes cannot get stuck together and be firmly attached without gliding. Here we have the lion running after his breakfast. This is a flexion extension which is used by virtually all species. This is a weightlifting, and now the weightlifter is transformed into a rower. It is the same machine used differently, but the forces transmitting from the hip extensors to the arm is always following the same path and distribution. We have some problem which have not been resolved. The muscle requires a supply of oxygen, glucose, and other nutrients, and removal, the product of combustions. So we must have a network of blood vessels that provide those nutrients and oxygen. But how is it possible to avoid damaging this network during very vigorous exercises? Imagine capillaries entering muscular structures and the muscular structures contracting violently. We cannot destroy those capillaries. We can ask the same questions for the central nervous system, which individual nerves must control and feed individual muscular fibers. In 2007, Dr. Gimberto surprised many people by demonstrating that the geometry of the collagen network is not rigid and can rapidly reorganize itself under stress. And that provides a reasonable explanation as to how the musculoskeletal system can maintain its versatility in force transmission, food supply, and nervous control of the muscles. This raises some questions. Yes, we would like to see an ideal collagenous structures which envelop every organ from the foot to the arms. But we have also to explain how the various segments of layers of fascia can transmit forces in different directions. The network of fibers which has been seen between the layers of collagen is too weak to support significant forces, so they cannot do it. We can raise a hypothesis: does it behave like a lubricant? And also, how can we protect the internal structures against external blows? We have to do that by dissipating the kinetic energy over large areas. And the redistribution of collagen network, as shown by Dr. Gimberto, is a possibility here. But that is also good news for the physical and manual therapist, because it rationalizes why the pressure which is applied on the surface of the skin is actually having an effect in the deeper structures. Another parameter is also the impact of the microvacuoles which are trapped within the collagen network. The resulting variation in hydraulic pressure should also participate in the dissipation of energy and the strengthening of the structures. This is a serious challenge to the classical representation and modeling of biomechanical system. The response of the tissues under stress should not be limited to the mechanical properties of the tissues, but should include the dynamic reconfiguration of the collagen network. And unfortunately, such a desirable analysis has not yet been done, as shown in the literature. Well, it is time now to hear directly from the inventor of these ideas, which are now widely accepted. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.